Well, I guess we can get started then.
And I suggest maybe we just remind everyone where we are and where idea came from. You came from a certain perspective, and I very well resonate with this. From my experience, I can say that lots of people who come to me, they have different idea about what meditation is. You are absolutely right, because lots of people are absolutely sure that meditation is something which is purely silent practice, where you go beyond words, where you still your mind, and it can be just some nice state, but there is nothing to remember out of it except maybe some nice sensations and feelings, aftertaste, after the whole experience. And then other people, probably coming from my experience, they're more into guided meditations, and they think, oh, I just put my earphones and listen to someone's voice guiding me into some nice place, or to find creative solutions, or solve my problems and do the healing. So that's completely different perspective of what meditation can be and do. And I don't see any contradiction there personally, and I'll speak about this a little bit more later. And again, from my experience, great experience, thanks to the mind mirror, I can very clearly and easily recognize non-meditators or beginning meditators, because as soon as we drift deeper into alpha and then deeper into theta, I can clearly see that their brain is basically used to sleep in that mode. You know, when we are going to theta, it means we are asleep. So we are seeing nice dreams probably, we are somewhere away, and they could be half conscious, but to them it's more like a relaxing dream that they are having with me, rather than something where they can consciously, you know, sustain alpha and work on, you know, what they're seeing, work with their content, and don't run away from it. So again, it can be trained. I understand that it's probably lack of their experience just to be awake on those frequencies to have, you know, better better presence, probably this is the key word, better presence in their life, and to stay, you know, peaceful, to stay centered, to stay connected to their creative powers, everything what we associate with awakened mind, right?
Yeah.
You know, within our work. So I don't know whether it's worth to retell the introduction, Judith, that you gave from Merriam-Webster Dictionary, which defines meditation as spending time in quiet thought for religious purposes or relaxation. So I can say I'm fully with that, and probably I'll just jump into my experience just to open you up a little bit and say, you know, how it worked for me, because I think I started seriously meditating somewhere in the beginning of 2010. So it's about 7 years. But it, once again, we should understand what meaning we invest into the word meditation. And I can say that over these 7 years, it was great inner transformation, largely because of meditation. Because the way I lived 7 years ago is completely different the way I live now. And it's not just the physical reality, because back then I was working for a big international corporation as a marketing manager in Moscow. So it was like stressful, top management position, lots of obligations, you know, lots of expectations from other people, lots of money, but it's stress, stress, stress. And I felt that I was caught up in this stressful world, you know, driven by these external stimuli and really not sensing myself much, losing myself, losing the very sensation of what life is, you know, when you can stop and enjoy the birds and the sun and the beauty and how divine the whole life can be. It was not quite part of my life that I was lacking, seriously lacking. It was lots of stress, lots of anxiety. And at that time, I realized seriously, I need something like regular, something to do, like to bring myself back to myself. And that's where meditation came in, because I think I wasn't the only one who was kind of externally driven, because we are all trying to, you know, find our means to survive, find our ways to build relationship with others. And it's quite competitive and, I should say, quite violent and aggressive world, especially if you go into this, you know, money corporations and big cities, and that's what it is all about. So it's, we're constantly under, you know, limitations of the physical reality, time stress, pressure. And I can say right now, just for the contrast, I'm living in a peaceful country environment in Australia, working from home. I can say that now I live not just during like 2 weeks vacation breaks, holiday breaks. I live all the time. I'm alive. I'm very conscious and present. And I did my best to find my way back to myself and reorganize my life so that it's worth living. It's worth being. It's enjoyable. And going
you know what's funny about this, Oksana, is that when you're talking about the corporate stuff, I could see your beta increasing. Your demeanor was increasing, you were speaking faster, more of this was going on, and then you start talking about being in the country and you start gearing on down. So what did you do? What was your first meditation practice? How did you come down from that?
It's a wonderful question because it's directly related to Anna Weiss. And it started even before. It was long before 2010. I tried to remember yesterday when it was, so I assume it was somewhere in the end of 2003 when I was doing my degree in psychology and exploring different schools and directions, and I went to the transpersonal workshop in Moscow. And that's where my instructor, Vladimir Maikov, he decided just to integrate without Anna Weiss's permission, I'm sorry for that, and just use some of her exercises to help us get into calmer, better state to prepare for breath work. Holotropic breath work. It's intensive breath work that helps you to release and work with certain deep, you know, issues. You can explore more if you are not familiar with Stanislav Grof work, so you can read more about that.
Stanislav Grof? Yeah, we know him. He's big here. He's real big here. Yeah.
So I was with a student of Stanislav Grof in Moscow, Vladimir Maikov, and he decided to do Anna Weiss's meditations on better reduction, on relaxation, and then we did House of Doors meditation. I was absolutely fascinated how easily I could relax and my mind could come down after relaxing my tongue. It was the heat, really. I was fascinated with brain waves and how it works, because it was my first introduction to this awakened mind work, and House of Doors meditation was really, really deep and profound for me, because I suddenly felt the kind of depth of my inner world. I recognized, oh, it's there. I was used to be so much on the surface, and then suddenly I realized, oh, it's like, you know, it's like going on some inner vacation, and this you know, few minutes of meditation that may seem to you that it's just hours and it's very deep experience, it's like it's better than going, I don't know, going mountain skiing in Austria for 2 weeks, because I can't compare, because you have the stress of, you know, spending money, going somewhere, carrying these heavy skis with you, and it's just lots of this kind of, I don't know, I call it limitations of the physical reality that you can't avoid just being on Earth. And then suddenly you can get more than that, more satisfaction for free in just a few minutes, just traveling inside. And I thought, wow, that's absolutely great work. And that's basically the beginning of my whole journey that continued much later. So I continued it in my thesis work, as Judith knows, about transformation of consciousness. And then, you know, I'm here with you now. So this didn't take me on like a path of regular meditations then. Back then, it wasn't just a need, deep need. But I still felt myself, you know, my whole life being very anxious and constantly lacking this presence, lacking this confidence, within myself. And I was pondering one day, and what is that anxiety about? Why am I constantly feeling this buzz, this like white noise inside? And then I had kind of an insight which said, you're not tuned enough to your inner antenna, to your inner radio. So you have to tune into yourself and stop being tuned into, you know, other people's expectations from you. Stop buying in into that. Stop betraying yourself because you just want to be a nice girl and please everyone. And and there is popular Russian autistic girl who learned how to type because she couldn't communicate. And then what she typed was shocking to most of people because she was very, very wise to her age. And she said, real sin is when you betray yourself. It's not the sin from religious point of view. It's the sin is when you are betraying your truth, when you're betraying yourself. So I completely agree with her. So going back to my first experiences with meditation, I thought I was just guided. I have always been guided to the right books in the bookstore and then with the internet to the right, I don't know, sources of information. And I found a couple of guided meditations. They were something like, they were in Russian and they were about cleansing and protection and reclaiming your power. Absolutely great meditations. They were a bit esoteric with nice music, nice voice. And I started doing them every day. I just thought, okay, I don't know how to meditate. I'll just start doing it. You know, sit quiet, you know, with straight back and close my eyes and just try to follow the directions. Imagine what they're talking about. Just do what I can do. And I can tell you that with time, so there was part of there like talking about Egyptian Ankh or Egyptian cross. And I never seen it. I thought, oh, I don't know what this is all about. I just... But then, you won't believe me, in one of meditations, I suddenly saw it. I just saw the cross. I said, that's what it is. That's how it looks like. And it just came to me as some knowledge from I don't know where. And as I progressed, just repeating the same things because I found them very grounding, very satisfying, very centering, I could start sensing my body more and more and more. And it was talking about this column of light inside you. So basically, if, you know, for any beginner, I can say, just keep doing it. Keep doing it. And just stay attentive, stay tuned in. And it will come to you, whatever it is talking about. If you're just drawn to this, it will unfold. Because then I found more meditations, I found more information about light workers that was completely new area for me, and the whole earth transformation. I never heard, I mean, at that time it was completely new to me. I was so caught up in corporate jobs, I didn't know what was going on. So I found other meditation by Salara. Maybe no, they're very esoteric again. They're about chakras and centering, working with your DNA. And one of the basic meditations that I absolutely enjoyed was a book and then meditations by Klaus Joller. I'm not sure that you know. I think originally he's German, but he lives in Canada. And it was about opening the flow of love and opening all your chakras. And I can say I always thought, oh, people who can sense their chakras, they must be really advanced. You know, they're like yogis. They're it's something unattainable. It's almost like magic. And then suddenly I found, wow, I can sense my chakras. I can actually sense their state, how open or closed they are and what's going on there, how much I'm closed, you know, confused, and how much I'm protecting myself. So I thought, wow, that's amazing. And then I did more and more meditations. I found that even what I did here in Australia, I could call them probably visual meditations with sacred geometry that visually affects your brain and balances your brain and calms you down. And especially one of the first meditations that we released on DVD, I say we because I worked with them for a while, it was about forgiveness. So it's clearly, I'm absolutely sure that people open their alpha and go in their theta and they do this release of the tension and sensitive material, and it's quite healing. And then the last experience that I enjoyed was practice of silence that I learned from the Russian doctor Dmitry Shemenkov, who set up the system of health management. I realized that just truly just sitting silent, if you do it properly, will instantly take you, not instantly, but will take you to theta. Sooner or later, you'll end up there. And to me, to describe to you the experience that I had when I got there first, I think it was when I was listening to Anna Weiss's CD with her meditations again on, you know, relaxation. I found, oh, I feel now like I was feeling when I was six years old. So it's that peace and presence and flow and lack of worry. So I won't say much now. I'll just conclude that after all this journey, I can say that, and after, by the way, our stress webinar, I can say that it's a little bit more than just finding your peace and balance and center and harmony. It's a little bit more than that. I found that it's, to me, it's truly very spiritual and very profound. It's more like connecting to my true core, connecting to the source, connecting to the God, use any word you like, connecting to high powers, creative powers that lie there and, you know, govern all the creation. And it's something that I truly can highly recommend for everyone, because after stress webinar, I suddenly realized probably the degree of stress that you experience shows just the degree of disconnection from that source. It just shows how much you don't let in, you don't trust these creative powers that created you, and that's your stress. Because when you, for example, learn or watch a couple of videos about even true religious saints, you manage to find good non-promotional videos, you'll find that these people are truly there and they don't have fear. They may have even physical problems that they can't fully repair or fix, but they don't have fear, they don't have anxiety, they have full trust, they have this peace, they have full presence. So I can say it's, yes, it's truly reconnection to that source. And nice. Then just to clarify a little bit, taking it further a little bit, I, again, with my some of people that I hooked up to the mind mirror, I found that when you talk about God, it can be not quite fully and resonating with the right thing in their minds, because some are prejudiced against this religion or that religion, and you don't really want maybe to mention the word God itself because it's so distorted these days. And then when you say the source to other people, it's too abstract and they really don't know how to connect with something abstract. So really the next step for me was trying to identify, thanks to some, you know, ancient Indian texts. I'm sure Krish would know and Nikate would know them. When you try to connect, when you say connect or just imagine the source, it's very hard for people to imagine that. But if you tell people, could you imagine the absolute beauty? And you'll understand somewhere subconsciously, people have very clear idea of what beauty is. Mm-hmm. And they instantly connect with this. Something like impeccable beauty, absolute beauty. And people instantly go into peace and balance. Basically, if you, they're hooked up to the mind mirror, they will open up evolve mind pattern. If they pass the stage of awakened mind, they'll open up, right? Then if you ask them to connect like kindness and care, what it means to you when someone is kind, care to you, and when they start imagining that, they'll instantly go there, they'll start opening up and go into evolved mind. And then to others, it can also be just unlimited wisdom and, you know, dimension, like higher perspective. There is no time, there are no limits there. That's the place where everything is possible, and kind of connecting to that ultimate wisdom and knowledge where, you know, all the knowledge is, it's again opens them up. And then the last thing that is great to connect with, it's just my kind of attributes of the source, if you like, or of the God, it's just to understand that behind all is very powerful creative life force, I define it, which is in constant motion, which is constantly changing, flowing, it's seeking expression, and it's bubbling with joy when it finds, you know, the way to express itself. So that's the final kind of key to me, to kind of let go of my little box, mind box, and the box of these obligations, expectations that creates all the worry and anxiety and makes me feel small and makes me feel, not fully in my power, not fully present, not fully trusting to what's going on, not fully open to my own, creative abilities, just to my own joy of life. That's the way to get out. That's meditation for me. So thank you.
Well, that's beautiful, Oksana. It's like you did a whole spectrum there, from high corporate stress all the way to getting connected to your source. And it sounds, if I understood correctly, like you were basically saying that you picked up this technique and that technique that taught you to focus your awareness. And then as you became more and more focused, then you were able to, partly with Anna's and Max's awakened mind meditations, once you encountered that subconscious piece, then you were able to just find your own way to your source and everything. And that's beautiful. And, I think we could probably all agree that that's what happens with meditation. I mean, I see Elizabeth's joined us here, so I'm going to ask you a question in a minute, Elizabeth. Merriam-Webster Dictionary said that defined meditation as a contemplative, possibly religious or spiritual practice. But actually, in Max's book, The Awakened Mind, he defined meditation as physical relaxation combined with mental inactivity. And so that, in the early days was a big confusion for me, because I had learned silent meditation and that was the one I knew. But then when I encountered awakened mind meditation, it's actually not mental activity, at least the way Anna brought it to the United States. It's really problem solving. You're actually holding a question, issue, or challenge in mind and allowing insights to come up from your deeper awareness. So I'd just like to ask you, Elizabeth, if you would talk to us about how you interpret meditation and the different types even of or approaches that you might want to talk about. Oh, and let me just do a little intro, because I know Steve and Tim, you may not know, Elizabeth St. John was one of Max's earliest students, and she knew and was kind of related to Anna Wise. And in fact, Isabel Cade told me when I visited her in, April of 2015 or 16, that she said that Elizabeth held on to the actual core of Max's work better than anybody else. So she really loved your understanding of it. So if we can have any comments.
Nowadays, and for several years, the only forms of meditation I do are the Qigong ones, the Taoist stuff. And they rely on the oceans of energy, internal and external, and connecting with the energies of the natural world. So I don't think I can really say anything about any other forms of meditation. Yes, I practiced lots. Yoga Nidra in particular is very useful. Do you know about Yoga Nidra? I'm sure you do, Judith. Yoga Nidra in Swami Satchananda's books, there's five forms, going from the very simple Ajapa Japa to the more complex ones, which consist of leaving your body. Yeah, I've practiced a lot of different things, and now it's simply the movement and the oceans of energy stuff.
But it's not partly because you're a healer? I mean, as a healer, that you would be connecting directly with that sea of light.
No, it's basically because I'm a mover. And I prefer movement forms to every other form. of meditation I discovered over years of practice.
You mean not sitting straight, not sitting still in a chair, but actually moving your body?
Well, in Qigong, yes.
Oh.
And there are many different forms of Qigong, some of which I found quite boring because they're repetitive. And others, the more flowing kind, and the medical Qigong practices, I've just found excellent.
Hmm. Okay. And then, so I know that Max taught some movement, but what was he teaching? Was he teaching movement or primarily sitting silent?
He couldn't move, really, but he encouraged everyone to dance, to do... I don't think there was any judo around, which was his thing. Aikido, ki aikido we did with Steve, who actually has just died on the 6th of March. He was a ki aikido teacher, which is an energy form of aikido. Yeah, Max encouraged movement because he himself was a great mover in the, back in the day when he could.
That's interesting. I don't think that shows up very much in his book. Now, of course, Anna was a dancer, and I know that she taught awakened mind meditation techniques to enhance the creativity of dancers. But I think most of us these days, partly because we're hooked up to the mind mirror, think of meditation as being a sitting practice, whether you're silent or whether you're doing an awakened mind meditation. But that's, and even Jim McRitchie, when he talked to us about Qigong, primarily we were not talking about the movement Qigong, but rather the mental movement of energy through the body. So this is a nice spin.
I spent many years working with Suprapto Suryadamo, a Buddhist in Java, who was a movement performance artist. And I learned a lot more about energy work through just doing that than I did in any other way.
Fantastic, fantastic. I wonder about you, Steve and Tim, and I think John was on here too. What about your practices? Do you, Don as well? What about your practices? Do any of you want to share with us?
I can say a few things about mine. I've been meditating about 20 years, and I came in through the back door, which is through hypnosis. I learned self-hypnosis techniques when I went through a hypnotherapy training program. But like Oksana, it was also due to having to find a way to cope with stress, because I was trying to work as a computer consultant at the time, and I just found that kind of technical work to be very stressful. So a friend of mine who was an amateur hypnotist, he said, well, why don't I hypnotize you? And when he did, it just opened up this whole realm of experience that I had never seen before. And I realized it was going to change my whole life. And so I took a program to learn hypnotherapy, and then I started practicing self-hypnosis, and I could go pretty deeply into that. And then I discovered Anna Wise's book, High Performance Mind, and that was another mind-blowing experience. So then my attention turned more to meditation, and then it also got me into biofeedback. So the way I meditate now is a lot of times with some kind of biofeedback, so I can tell, like for example, I have one that measures skin conductance, so I can hear a tone, and as I relax, I can tell as I'm relaxing, and that kind of, it gives me something to meditate on besides just, you know, my breath or my body or whatever. So I also have like an EEG that I can hook up to, not the mind mirror, but another one, so I can listen to my brain waves. So those have been very helpful. I feel like those have helped me a lot. And then, sometimes I go through periods where I don't use any of that, and I just like to lay down and really go into it and see what kind of an inner experience I can have.
Beautiful. So what this machine, may I ask, that you have that you listen to your brainwaves, what is that? I might know something about that.
The name of it is NeuroBit Light. I bought it about 5 or 6 years ago. So I thought it was really a breakthrough technology for me to discover, because it was the first time when I could really just get a handle on what I was feeling inside. Because, you know, other kinds of biofeedback like skin resistance and heart rate variability and stuff, they give you clues, but it's not until you listen to your brain waves that you really get an understanding what's going on inside your head. And I found that what I was really at as far as meditation was in like the high theta, low alpha range. That's just kind of where I love to be. So I put it on a setting for, you know, to give me feedback in that range. And I could just spend, like, I could just spend 2 hours solid just listening to how I would do more of that frequency range or less of that frequency range. And I felt that through, I guess, a period of about a year, it just gave me a really good handle on anger management that I had never had before. But these days, I was just using it recently. I got out recently, and I kind of prefer just to listen to the alpha range. I like to hear, you know, when I make more alpha, less alpha. It's very helpful.
It's fascinating. So how are you going to use the mind mirror? You just got a mind mirror. What made you want to get it, and what are you going to do with it?
Well, like I said, I ran into Anna Weiss's book, High Performance Mind, many years ago. And I'd been thinking about Mind Mirror all this time, and I did a few sessions with Anna, and you know, it was kind of out there as a hill to climb, a mountain to climb, but I hadn't quite gotten there yet. You know, how could I really integrate that into my life or integrate that into my meditation practice or whatever? So I finally sort of got over, you know, my inhibitions, and I realized, well, you know, it's time to just, you know, see what kind of patterns I'm making when I meditate. I really need to know where I'm at, how deeply I'm going. And I also have this impetus that I would just love to hook up other people. I have ideas that I got from being hooked up with Anna. I got ideas about things I could do with them that I would love to try, not really as a professional, but, you know, just to see if I can help people with it. So I hooked myself to make up sure it was working and everything. And then when I could get down to the first surprise was that, you know, a mind mirror without Anna Weiss is nothing like a mind mirror with Anna Weiss. The mind mirror is actually kind of an intimidating. It's kind of like running up and seeing a wall. But with Anna Weiss on the other side of the wall to help you pull it over, it's a totally different experience. So it was totally up to me to get relaxed and get a good pattern on the mind mirror. So that was, that itself was kind of a revelation. So anyway, I managed to, you know, get a fairly decent pattern, and I showed it to my mom, and I explained what the different frequencies were. And I was amazed because even so, though she had never read any of this literature, she immediately picked up on what I was talking about. And we had a really deep discussion about, you know, how I need to bring out more of my empathetic side and this kind of stuff. So far it's been very revealing.
Fantastic. That's wonderful. That's wonderful that you've been such a mind explorer for so long and in different ways as well. I'd be curious to see if you can run both of those machines at the same time. The one that lets you listen to your brainwaves and then to see what those, see what, how the mind mirror interpreted that, whether in fact the low alpha, high theta, that's where you feel comfortable, is the alpha theta that it is within the ratios of the awakened mind pattern. Probably is, but it'd be curious to see. And if your beta is quiet enough, when on the other machine, you're just a thought. That is interesting. I wonder, Tim, can we ask you something? Can you tell us about your practice or any questions that you might have or comments on what anybody else has said?
Sure. Well, I would say, first of all, that my meditation practice is consistently inconsistent. So I really feel like more meditation calls me, you know, and I don't necessarily force it. I sort of wait for those moments when life says you need to meditate. It almost as if my brain starts to get a signal that I need to go quiet. It's funny because my very first meditation that I did was, you know, it was probably my best meditation, which is kind of ironic. You think like, you know, you continue to improve over time, but I feel like in some ways I'm trying to go back to that very first meditation. I remember I learned to meditate. I was, I went to like a Zen group that was in the city, and they were teaching basic meditation. And I just had so much sort of light, and I saw the light, and I saw it come down, and it was such a beautiful experience. My heart opened. And I was telling everybody about this, and they were looking at me like I was kind of crazy, in a sense, because this is the first time you ever sit and meditate, and all of a sudden you get all these euphoric experiences. But it really changed me at that point. I knew a deep change had come over me. And it took a while because I felt like I really sort of had to understand it. I didn't know what it really meant. It's just things in life that what were really important to me, like skiing. I just had no desire to do any more skiing. It just felt like a lot of the outward worldly things that I pursued just totally dropped away in terms of my interest. But I've played around. I think us Sagittariuses, you know, I'll blame it on my sign. We tend to be explorers, you know. We don't like to sit idle. We like to try things. So I have tried guided meditations. I enjoy guided meditations. I think they can be very profound. I have done times when I just be silent, just let the silence come in. I also feel like sort of like just being present to myself, sort of a mindfulness, whereas even without, you know, saying I'm meditating, just the idea that I'm sort of having awareness of myself at the same time that I'm engaged in the world. So maybe that is sort of like an awakened pattern, right? You're holding that other sort of sense of expansion at the same time that you're engaged in whatever you're doing. To me, that's when that sort of that feeling of connectedness is able to sort of come through. I also kind of feel like these days, a lot of it is for me is like also asking, you know, asking for what I want, right? So it's like the universe is sort of saying, okay, Tim, what do you want? You know, what do you want to deal with? Just to give you an example, like last night I was dreaming and I had these fears that were coming up in my dream. And I kept thinking, well, maybe it's really a time just to ask to let that fear go. And in a way, letting the universe with that sort of invocation for the universe and saying, hey, here's an issue that I'm seeing. And now I want some support to let it go. And then see how that sort of take form, what kind of form that might take. You know, will that be, I'm going to be wanting to meditate now to sort of let that energy come in. Will it be the mind mirror? It's kind of like, I think there's sort of a dance that you do, but you're sort of responding to how the universe is asking you to sort of pay attention. So I've been all over the place, okay, but it's been fun. It's definitely been a wonderful journey.
That's really nice that that the universe decided to light you up from the start.
I know. I'm just, you know, I think that's beautiful. I do hear other people who get light up from the start and then they stay open. You know, it's once they're open, they're continually open. And for some of us, it feels like you get open and you're like, okay, I want more. You know, that was so good. That you try to get, you know, your life is trying to get back to that permanent state.
Absolutely.
I think we all are, right? We all get those moments where it just feel like, you know, we do get lighted up, and I think we just we start our journey. We start on the path, and then I think for most people it ends when you are just there. You know, You're always lit up. You're always open.
I don't know that anyone has ever done studies that show anything about the progression of meditation like that. You know, like how many people get lit up from the start, you know, at versus how many people do a slow progression down into the inner peace, you know, reduce that beta, get it down into the inner peace and alpha and theta. And then how long does it take those people who are doing the little step-by-step thing to get all the way to the other end of the spectrum where you get lit up? Because if everybody got lit up from the start, then there would be fewer people who walk away from meditation saying, I can't quiet my monkey mind. I'm never going to do this anymore. It'd be cool if we could have developed some technology that just, boom, lit them right up. I mean, of course, you can get into your awakened mind. And like Oksana said, you can get into your theta. And then you realize that there's something extraordinary there that's worth going back to. But that's different from getting lit up, isn't it, Tim?
Sure.
That's different. That's a revelatory. That's a, almost a maybe it is a spontaneous illumination.
I think it was. It was I know they use like miniature Satori, I think, is some ways that people describe that. And that it was beautiful, and it was, you know, it was totally a gift. You know, it was you know, use a Christian word. It was definitely grace that sort of bestowed that on you. And so I always, in my mind, I kind of think it's sort of we're always being open to that grace coming in again.
Yeah. You know, Anna said something about that. She said that you can work to get into the awakened mind pattern and have your awakening there, the unification of your brain waves. But enlightenment doesn't come in a box. That movement from the awakened mind to the evolved mind is an act of grace.
Yeah, I totally agree with that statement.
Yeah. Oksana, let's come back to you. What was your big aha you wanted to share?
First, Tim reminded me of, as we are talking about meditation and insights, I had lots of insights after these transpersonal workshops, holotropic breathwork workshops, right? Because it first helps you to release all the tension out of your body, and then it releases all the blocks out of your mind too. So I had a dream. And in a dream, Judith, you probably heard all these stories from me before. I had a dream where I felt that I was a flute. You know, like a flute, you are open and you feel the air flowing through you, and where your chakras are these little holes that produce different, you know, tones, different notes. And I thought, wow, it's so great. That's what we truly are. There is this air, this force traveling through us and playing certain melody through us. So I felt myself like this open flute. And then the next revelation was, but it's up to us to kind of what kind of melody we play, or it's more like what you are tuned into. So when we talk about meditation, another great word, I think, is tuning. And tuning to these natural powers, natural energies, the source, the God, that's kind of is the ultimate purpose for me, right? And then another thing that he mentioned about opening and lightening, I think it was very, very unusual experience in general when at that same stage during my last corporate work in Moscow, I suddenly decided I'm lacking this magic dimension in my life. I need to do something about it. And I, like, you know, being in this doing mode, not more than being mode, because work, I mean, corporate world implies that. I thought, okay, I'll go and apply for clairvoyant course at Clairvoyant Academy. And when I showed up there, they asked me to fill in the application for an interview with their director, just to check how sane I am, or whether I'm, you know, would be allowed to do this course. And in the bottom, you know, like usually you fill applications, there is date, just normal date, right? But instead of date, they had the phrase, it was in Russian, of course, but it said something like opened at or on, you know. And I was like, am I a bottle to open me up? Why do they use this strange terminology? What are they going to do? It was really weird to me to see this opened on and then the date. And I was like, oh. And then a couple of more very unusual experiences that I had on that same day, because I arrived on time, but I had to wait because apparently this director was doing healing sessions with others and interviews, you know, with someone like me. And she was literally just seeing one person after the other. And while waiting, I could hear some light, you know, not very loud music coming from one of the rooms. And then I felt a very similar experience to what Tim described, like lots of light filled the space. The epicenter was there in that room, but where I was in the waiting room, I could sense that light. And I thought, wow, the person must be receiving some healing. And it's really intense, this love and light concentrated on that person, that even me sitting in the waiting room can feel that. And I was looking around at other people waiting and thought, like, why don't you feel the same? It's amazing. It's such a great thing, especially after a stressful day at work in the evening, just to be exposed to this thing. And they seem not to show any signs of the same experience, you know, whatever I picked up. They were just reading newspapers, doing their usual things, you know, staring in the phone. And I was like, wow, that's amazing.
Beautiful.
And then later, so that was just the interview where, yeah, the director told all sorts of weird things, something like she was looking through me, mentioning I had some clairvoyant abilities, not developed fully, though I have the potential, and mentioning I have connections with Lemurians. And I thought, oh, I never heard who they are, you know, some strange animals or what, just what's that is, it sounds strange. And then it started my whole search for, you know, these ancient civilizations. Of course, everyone in Russia heard about Atlantis, but nobody heard about Lemurians. And I had to search for, and that's how I ended up, you know, finding all the light workers and all the whole dimension that never existed for me until that day. And on the day of the training itself, there was a very exciting experience when I was asked to do a meditation to connect with my higher self, or to connect with my guide, with my teacher, spiritual teacher or instructor. And it was basically the end of my clairvoyant training, and I kind of was in quite skeptical about it, really, in disbelief. I thought, oh, it's just another fantasy, you know, nothing would happen and nobody will, you know, would show up. And then suddenly, seriously, out of the blue, I felt the presence first, and I felt the presence of someone very light and very loving. And I could even see the figure of whoever that was, being, personality, I can't describe that. But what was the key from that experience was the expression of overwhelming love. And I started melting inside. I started feeling how all my stress and anxiety and fears from the day are melting inside. And I literally started crying. So I had tears coming out of my eyes and feeling like, oh, I feel like a little girl coming back home. And I missed that state so much, having quite stressful life. I felt, wow, that must be the experience that people have when they die. And I thought, wow, I don't have to die to get there. It's almost similar, very close to what, you know, Anna Weiss described about her near-death experience. It wasn't death for me. It wasn't anything risky or critical. But it was quite profound just to see someone and get back to that state of being at home and experiencing that sensation of being fully accepted, fully loved, fully cared. There was no worry, no hurry, no anxiety, no fear. In this fearless state, it was so liberating. So, yeah, another dimension, I guess, of meditation is when you go to sense yourself as a free spirit, free and fearless, and it's extremely liberating. So that's all I wanted to add. Thank you.
Well, you know, now you bring up another, literally another dimension of meditation. And I wonder if anybody here has had experiences like Oksana has spoken of, where it's not just light, it's somebody else showing up.
I'd like to share. A whole bunch of pieces have come out that I wanted to respond to. The first one is, I really wanted to say hi to Elizabeth. It's been about 35 years since I last saw you in Max's course. I doubt that you remember me, but I remember you clearly. And Steve, you were saying about your computing stuff. When we were doing the Festival of Mind and Body in London, one of the things that I found was that many computer people actually have the ability to go into the state spontaneously, and they don't realize it. And one of the ways that I would encourage them was to say, imagine you're debugging a current program, and virtually every one of them would drop into the fifth state. So I think there's something about how we use our mind that gets us there. It's kind of neat. And as for what Oksana was saying, back up one. I think it was it John was saying about the first spontaneous light experience. I had that twice. The first time it was just an absolute knowing, and the second time it was a light experience, and I didn't know what I was experiencing until I talked to some other meditators and they explained to me what was happening. I've been meditating for over 40 years, and I've done a lot of different kinds of meditation. I use it for a lot of different things, including working with clients. And I've also done monitoring of people who are psychic or mediums. And I do mediumistic work myself, but what I found in working with mediums is that they tend to show a fifth state. A good medium tends to show a fifth state, but if they're a trance medium, the beta aspect of the top of the screen disappears momentarily and then comes back when the channeled entity comes in. It's almost like they quiet themselves and then another being takes over at the beta level. But the bottom half of the fifth state stays. And I have this, I worked with this wonderful psychic medium person, and we were all hooked up, and she was waiting to go in to channel, and someone knocked at the door, and she was holding this beautiful fifth state, and there was this incredible flare of delta that lasted for all of 2 seconds, and then she said, oh yeah, that's fine, and then she went on.
I love what you're saying, and I hope you get a chance to read the article that I wrote for this current issue of the Eureka Times newspaper. Do you get webinar notifications, so you're getting the newsletter too, and it's exactly that. I mean, this is this woman that I did the study on, PMH Atwater, who is a near-death survivor, was talking about dowsers having that pattern, and near-death survivors also having that pattern. And then I had talked a lot with Oksana about the Taurus, and it's a fascinating study. It's an interesting enough story about PMH herself, which is a contextual article, but the study is fascinating because that's what it shows, is that there's this dive down into delta that's really brief, and boom, then there's high beta and gamma come up, and then the person is in this gamma pattern. And I think that's what you're talking about. I'd love it if you would write up some of that or show some screenshots and just describe it. It is fascinating, and it looks like in relation to the Taurus and in relation to the mind mirror, the Dowser and the NDE patterns, which are the same shape, big beta, gamma, a little bit of alpha, and then a ton of theta delta, is that it's a dynamic flow movement from the lowest to the highest frequencies, and that there's just this loop between the two, and that indeed people are moving from one, and that this also happens at the moment of death, is that the same exact pattern shows up. Scientists have since found out, and you see all this dive into delta, and then the person flatlines, the brainwaves flatline. We would see it as a flat line. They see it as a flat line. And then there's this huge surge of gamma that lasts for up to 20 minutes after the person's deader than a doornail. I mean, they're transitioning from, looks like the bottom of the Taurus to the top of the Taurus, and just going through a tunnel into another dimension. And it's absolutely fascinating. I think, you know, seeing this on the mind mirror, you're seeing it on the mind mirror, am I seeing it on the mind mirror? We all need to start looking for this, because I think we're talking about an interdimensional shift, especially if you see all of the categories in the brain and the mind mirror pattern as each a dimension. I mean, delta is a dimension of intuition, psychic, searching for something and processing it very deeply, and theta is a dimension of the subconscious mind and your memories and your essential being, and alpha is the dimension of the sensory awareness, inner and outer, and beta is your, I mean, that's, these are all levels, these are dimensions of consciousness, they're literally dimensions. So the awakened mind puts all these dimensions together, but boy, when you go from that beginning of that spectrum of that stress across through focus awareness into that awakened mind, and then maybe you're going to go baby steps to your boom, your evolved mind pattern, there's another dimension past there. And there, it's very much involving gamma and these very, the very brainwave pattern you just talked about. It's fascinating. And Garth, I see Garth Fisher is online with us too. Even if we can't see you, Garth, do you want to comment on that? Because I've hooked Garth up and shown his brainwaves on a webinar. It was the Case Studies Folio 1. And Garth is a medium. What do you call yourself, Garth? A spiritualist?
I don't have a webcam.
Alas. Well, just talk to us then. We'll consider you a mediumistic voice from the other side.
Okay. I call myself an intuitive consultant or intuitive worker who taps into potentials for the future. That's the best way I can say it.
And what about the relationship of your intuition to your gamma as we've seen it on the mind mirror? Can you say something about that?
That was all new to me, so I'm hoping about 3 months to be able to tell you a lot more about it.
Wonderful. I hope you'll keep measuring it. On your behalf, since I've already exposed your brainwaves to the world through that case studies folio,
yes,
I can just say that that Garth went up into his, he did a reading for me, and of course he was hooked up, and I just saw his gamma steadily increase. We saw it through the gamma amplitude summary, and his gamma was completely increasing, and especially at the point when he starts channeling about what gamma is and the levels of gamma. And I won't go to it now. It's a really fascinating program to watch. But the bottom line is that that's where people in these high frequencies are getting this information. And it looks like even healers who are producing this high amplitude delta, they're also triggering this gamma, which rides on top. And even Richard Schuster, a Hawaiian psychiatrist who's running some, for years he's been working on some studies, with his clients, and he's seeing them increase their theta. And while they do the work of lucid dreaming, interpreting their dreams in their theta, their gamma increases. So there are some wonderfully connected, I mean, it's all connected, certainly, but the deeper you go, the higher you get, and the higher you go, the farther along that spectrum you move, because you move into that light and that awareness, that super conscious awareness, and then stuff starts to happen. You start getting messages, and you know things precognitively, and synchronicity increases. And it's a very fascinating spectrum. I would say that in this sense, the Merriam-Webster dictionary falls very far short of a good meditation definition.
Can I just reinforce something that you said? I'm not sure that meditation is any one thing. And I think all of the things that we're talking about are all parts of meditation as a tool to give us the ability to do whatever we're going to do, whether we're going to heal or channel or be intuitive or just relax. I don't think that meditation has one goal except giving us these abilities.
Very nice. So maybe it's just whatever channel you're tuned to or whatever it is that you need at the time is as far as you go, however fast you go. And I would certainly agree with that. Wouldn't you, everyone?
So is my voice coming in? This is Garth.
It is.
Okay, so I did a healing session on a long, long time friend of mine who's been profoundly depressed. And I did it last week. And while I was doing the protocol that I was doing, which included some hands-on things, I could feel the top of my head gamma type thing going on. And that translated into a pulsing into my hands that then I sort of went over different limbs and arms and head and that kind of thing. But it's the first time I've had that kind of sensation. And I picked up that awareness when I was there with you, Judith, down in Virginia last year. But it was a replay.
Yeah, and it wasn't just that on this case studies folio one that we were looking at your extraordinary brainwave patterns when you were channeling and also doing lots of other things. You had a lot of gamma and other situations as well. But it was that, and this is what I kept emphasizing, is that you had such a wonderful recognition within your body of where your gamma was and what it felt like. It was just perfect that you were able to find those landmarks. So that's very cool.
Well, and then it translated into an actual sense of pulsing energy through my hands, which is something I've been doing Tai Chi for 5 years and developing some sense of energy in the hands, but this was a pulsing sensation, and I believe along with the gamma.
Fantastic. Fantastic. I wonder if Elizabeth has any comment on that, because she's a healer as well. Anything from you on that, Elizabeth?
Yes, I think so. One comment that I guess it's Tim was talking about was the delta flares. And I did quite a bit of work with mediums back in the day. And I would say we would see invariably a right delta flare followed by a left delta flare followed by an increase in theta, right hemisphere, increase in theta, left hemisphere, till the thetas came into balance. So it was like bringing information up from the delta level into the theta level.
Well, that makes perfect sense, because the energy would be flowing upwards so that you could become conscious of it, wouldn't it?
Yes. Yeah. I was just saying that's what we observed. And then the other thing is in the movement work in Java, the emphasis was being present in the moment, in movement, which at first as a Western person, it was quite difficult for me to get into. But once you get into the zone, which happens in meditation and athletics, then everything becomes spontaneous, completely spontaneous, without thought. And yet you can move a narrative in that state. In other words, you can tell a story in that state, even though there's this no mind state. And thinking about light and energy experiences, I think my most important, no, that's not the word, changing experience is that of no mind.
You know, I have to agree with you on that. Certainly, for me, I don't need to tell you my story, but I could just pick up some little pieces so I can get to my point, is that starting out as a very speedy and type A, even though I had that, I was a writer, so I had a high level of ability to concentrate. But still, I lived in fragmentation a lot. And I started out with meditative writing where I was like listening to really a voice inside of myself and didn't know that anybody had ever done that before. This is way long time ago. And I started hearing my inner voice. There's a lot of psychic stuff in it. I even ended up writing a book about it called The Voice of the Soul much later on. But this voice started to say that it would tell me when something extraordinary was going to happen. And it had been saying that I needed to learn to meditate. And then I would soon encounter my opportunity to learn to meditate. And sure enough, I did. And went to San Francisco in a bookstore and ran across these books by Edgar Cayce. And Edgar Cayce, I just fell in love with him, just fell in love with the man, the personage, the kindness within him, and of course his extraordinary psychic abilities, but just his kindness and generosity and such a humble person. And I lost the books on the airplane, and then synchronistically the ARE found me just out of the blue, and I did end up learning to meditate. My meditative writings were absolutely right about that, and joined through a lot of other synchronicities, a study group that came and met at my house for 10 years once a week, and the first chapter of the little book called A Search for God, the text that we studied every week, was on meditation. And every single thing in that chapter was every single thing about the science of spirituality and meditation that my meditative writings had been teaching me for 7 years before that. And what Cayce, so it was always about silent meditation for me, long before I encountered the awakened mind work. And I found that when I would go into silent meditation, all of that light would flow. And in fact, it was no different. And I hooked myself up to the mind mirror and seen that indeed it is no different. When I'm doing a meditative writing and listening inside with my eyes open and writing down what I hear, it's the exact same partially evolved mind pattern as when I'm sitting there in silent meditation. But my point being that Edgar Cayce said that you are spiritualized by meditation, and that's what I find. that is what moves our progression from high beta on, that there is an energy that flows during meditation. When you quiet your mind, when you center in your alpha theta, that this beautiful energy flows into and through you and ultimately out of you as healer, if that's your direction. And that it does evolve your brainwaves. And that is the act of grace that moves you from the awakened mind to the evolved mind pattern. And I love what you said, Elizabeth, about you can move a narrative. So that would be what we're doing when we're doing the creative problem solving inside awakened mind meditation. And that certainly is evolutionary. And can be externalized, but I still believe that it's an, or at least from my experience, maybe it's not this way for everyone, but for me, it's been about going into silent meditation and just through love and gratitude, connecting with that force, that source, and feeling that joy that arises. That's been the real evolver for me. And I've also met my brainwaves from 2005 to date. And I don't really do, I mean, certainly I'll sit down and problem solve and do my meditative writings and directly seek answers and insights. But what I've seen has really evolved my consciousness has been sitting in that silence, connecting with that source, that force, that light, and just loving it and not even necessarily setting a goal or an intention for the meditation, but just being present, sitting in silence and being present and flowing with that. And I think you can do that, as you say, with movement. You can do it silently, sitting, silent meditation, but that the real evolver is that connection. Hmm. Would anybody agree with that? Sounds like you would, Gar.
It just sounds very familiar, yes. She mentioned sports. A long time ago, I used to do a lot of rock climbing, and I would hit a spot sometimes where I was just completely stuck, and I would drop down into what I now would call meditation. Then I didn't know that, and then all of a sudden, I just found all these little spots and all these little places, and eventually I was up on top of where I was trying to get to. And I wrote an article called Dancing on the Rocks. And that was getting into that zone that was mentioned earlier. And I guess I get into a similar kind of zone when I backpack, or a similar kind of zone when I'm doing a consultation with someone. It all has similar feel about it now that I know that.
Well, you know, that's interesting because... Because Garth is a social worker, and so do you mean when you're working with someone in a psychotherapeutic session?
Well, back when I used to do a lot of hypnosis and relaxation training with people, I found that both of us would get into the zone, and there were times that I would know what they were going to say, or they would know what I was going to say. When I'm sitting in an office now, I just go into my meditative state and try and be spontaneous with whatever, however I respond to what they're saying.
Mind link, the Delta mind link.
Yes.
Inside the awakened mind pattern, right? I mean, that is your, and that's what we've been saying here, is that what it is that you do, that you love, Don was saying that, whatever it is that you love that turns you on, there's your aha, isn't it?
Yes.
And when you've got the aha, well then, hello empathy and interconnection and insights and everything you need to evolve.
Yes.
There is a John. Do you want to share something?
Oh, John, is that me?
Do you have any comments on any of this?
Oh, I think it's great. I'm enjoying every bit of it.
Yeah. Did you have a meditation practice before you encountered the awakened mind and the mind mirror?
Oh, yeah. I just got back from that's why I'm so relaxed right now. I got back from what I think is a great meditation with people. It's a very unique experience of movement It's movement meditation. So
like how?
Yeah. Oh, it's just doing spontaneous kind of group meditation with other people. I find it's a really rare and wonderful to be with other people without speaking. And I think it's quite, for me, it's just wonderful. So I think we spend a lot of time, at least I do, in conversation. So it's a rare opportunity to be with, especially other men, I have to say, without speaking at all, which just find it really wonderful. So just for me, meditation in a nutshell is just basically paying attention to whatever's happening. And, you know, there's so many, everybody's so unique, and we have our own ways of being and experiencing ourselves. That's part of what I'm interested in. I'm just kind of pursuing the idea of becoming a beginner at learning some of the things you all know. So being able to recognize these different places in ourselves, you know, through a graphic medium. It's just another way of being able to talk and relate in some coherent way with other people about their very unique experiences. Because, I mean, I'm familiar with all kinds of different experiences in myself and in other people, and how to talk about them. You know, that's my experience. It's a challenge. It's like, and around here I come from, I'm in California, and so they talk about wine tasting, you know. And, you know, we have this, all this litany of words about what it is to experience this particular wine. But honestly, I'm not sure we really ever talk about the same thing. So, not that it really matters, but we either enjoy the wine or we don't. So all these different mind states, as wonderful as they can be, it's kind of nice for me. It's kind of an interesting adventure to embark on understanding more of it for myself and how they relate to my own personal experience.
That's lovely. And you bring us back to the whole concept of being present, you know, that being really so much of the key. It's not just focusing your awareness, it's being focusing your awareness to be present to yourself is how I really interpret it and experience it. That is the reason so many people can't do it. that's a quantum leap, isn't it, between the non-meditator and the meditator, is to catch hold of yourself and bring those runaway thoughts and that externalized focus into yourself and to hold it, to stay there, to hold it and not fall asleep.
Can I jump in with the idea here?
Yeah.
Of whole, you know, being able to accept yourself, of course, first of all, and then being able to go further than that, and that's sort of where meditation starts. And I wanted to tell you about how it was for me when I first started. Of course, you know, everybody meditates when they're, you know, an infant and a young child in a very different way than an adult would. So when we say we've been meditating for 20 years or 40 years, we mean after a gap where we lost it from childhood, right? But when I came back to it, the first kind of inner experiences I had were pertaining to seeing myself as having made a mistake. In other words, I would go into this, you know, kind of relaxed state of mind, and then images would start coming to my mind. And the important thing is that these images kind of pertain to myself. And that's kind of why I say that was the beginning of meditation, because I might have seen myself favorably or unfavorably. That's how I just sort of came back to it in the very beginning. I just want to kind of throw that out. So, of course, obviously you go way, way past there. I mean, but it's been very, very interesting, because all the meditators, you know, who've been speaking in this program, they give me a handle. And I haven't experienced this before, because I don't know a lot of people who meditate, but Judith gives me a definite handle. Oksana gives me a definite handle. And some of what Oksana said, I found very touching. And what I particularly like about, you know, her kind of style of meditation is that she can reduce it to an abstraction. And I know for most of the participants I've been listening to, it kind of eventually ends up in a spiritual state of some kind, where I don't think that's so much true of me. But I feel like I have a special connection with Oksana, because she can reduce it to a neutral ground of abstraction, where it's neither psychological nor is it spiritual, but it's sort of an in between place. And I kind of wanted to ask her about that. Is that where ultimately, is that kind of your goal, is to get it down to an abstract concept, or am I simplifying it too much?
Not really. I think there are different keys to every person, right? Some people, abstract concept maybe, like to you, would sound easier to connect with. You'll be less prejudiced, right? You'll be less closed. You'll be more open to accept something abstract. Some other people, they need more concrete things, like something they can resonate with. So it's just finding different keys for different people, without kind of, because words, they could be misleading, right? They're just pointers. And what I invest, say, in the word God, as I said, can be completely different to another person who has Allah, or someone else doesn't like this particular word, just doesn't like it, or it has bad associations with it. So just to avoid all these misleading associations and take people to neutral ground where the path is open for them, that's the way. And then again, testing it with, the people I worked with, it's really good to see how quickly they react to you. Even like I found, not just God, when people say God is absolute love, and then love is again a very abstract concept to many people. It's just they can't resonate with it. Oh, it sounds great. It's something nice, probably. Something pleasant, probably. Maybe associated with warmth, probably. But they just can't quite connect with it, right? And if you say connect, as I said, with beauty, connect with kindness and care, connect with even gratitude when you're thankful to someone, and that will give them more clues than just some abstract concept. So I'm just exploring that and finding ways, for different people, opening up doors for them. That's all. No special goal. The goal is open up the doors, open up the paths for other people so they can find theirs, their clues, their keys, their landmarks. And since I'm talking anyway, I want to emphasize one more thing that I find very key. We mentioned that before. Everyone, I think, of the speakers mentioned it. When I was talking about the flute, I meant, yes, the flute, like you are open. You have the end where all the air is coming in and the end where all the air is coming out. So you can think of yourself as a conduit of this source life energy that is going, traveling through you. And I think the key words there are to stay also open. And the trick is to stay open and allow these energies to travel through you, to allow whatever mediums are doing, the information traveling through you, to allow. Because the truth is that, yes, these higher powers, these life energies, they are constant, in constant motion. They are this flow, they are this life, and they have all the ingredients there. And it's just hard for us because we lack this trust. We can't quite open up. That's why in the very beginning I said, just basically your stress is the degree of how much you are disconnected from these vital energies, from these source energies. It's so true. And the trick is to how can you open up towards them. And of course, you open up through relaxation. You open up through just letting and allowing things to happen. And in mental realm, if you like, I really liked, and I mentioned that before as well in one of the previous webinars, what was recommended for practice of silence by the Russian doctor, Dmitry Shimenkov, and he pointed out quite a few principles or quite a few things to think about while you're trying to do your silent meditation. Well, you're trying to connect with these higher powers, because he said, first you have to let go of all, try to relax your body, of course, as much as you can and with the tools that you know. And then you try to let go of all the obligations and expectations from yourself and, you know, others, because this is a huge block. And as I said, in this externally driven world, you know, where we are externally driven, we lose our center. All these obligations, expectations, they may lead to us losing ourselves, losing our truth, losing our presence. We are ready just to betray ourselves to preserve peace and stay in nice relationship. We're afraid of conflict. We're afraid of not being accepted. So from here, from expectations, obligations, I move to the next step, acceptance, which is very critical. And it has more than just acceptance. It's forgiving yourself for all your defaults, for all your mistakes, for whatever is imperfect in you. And as soon as you do that, you know, it opens the truth for you. It opens what was hiding from you. And so basically, letting go of expectations, obligations, allowing acceptance to happen. First of all, you accept yourself as you are, as it is. And it's very, very liberating. As soon as you accept yourself, you are ready and you are courageous enough to see the truth, because it may be hiding from you, because it may be too painful or unpleasant to see some truths about yourself. You just can't forgive and you are caught up in constant conflict and fight, and it leads to nowhere. So you open up and you allow yourself to accept. You allow things to happen as they are. You allow honesty to come in. With honesty comes in the wisdom, you know, of what the things are. So basically, key components there, try to see yourself free, as free spirit, really. Free spirit. And as soon as you let go of tension in your body, you relax. As soon as you let go of expectations and obligations in your mind that clutter your mind and keep you in a box and kind of block really your mind from receiving whatever high, you know, perspective is, whatever the universe wants from you, because we should remember with our minds, we have quite limited perspectives of what we know about life, how things work. We're quite prejudiced. We have filters. So open up these filters and let the universe, you know, do its magic, guide you in the way that is the most beneficial for you and everyone. But you have to open up and, you know, let things happen. So you accept and you are honest. And that way you get present, and that way you let things happen. So as soon as you open up, it will just happen automatically. That's the nature of things. So I think that's absolutely great. We should remember it's a natural process. We are just usually blocking ourselves with all sorts of things, physically, mentally. Just as soon as you open you up, it will happen. And from what I read and learned and heard today again from our mediums and channelers and healers, it's not you, it's not your little ego and your little mind doing the magic, doing the healing or receiving the information. It's just you allowing this to happen, you opening up. And one of the meditations from what I learned on how to develop these abilities is also imagine yourself just empty. Or probably imagining myself as a flute has a similar effect. As empty as you are ready to receive and let it flow through you. So if this could be helpful to anyone, I thought this is important to emphasize too. Thank you.
Yeah, I was just particularly interested in the connection with the self, you know, because I think my goal in meditation is to fully understand myself. I hadn't really thought in terms of the openness that you were mentioning, you know, to allow myself to be more open, but I can definitely work on that.
So are you saying you are interested in connecting with yourself? So basically, yeah. When you open, the thing is, part of the silent meditation is that you're just opening all the blocks and then you let yourself listen. You just listen. That's the trick. Silence doesn't mean that just I'm silent completely. Yes, you are in a way passive, but passive and active, because you are listening, right? You stop your mind chatter. You get away of all distractions, right? Like all this pressure and obligations and, you know, physical world limitations, whatever is pressing you, you let go of it. And then you create the ground for receiving. It's like in this, you know, sometimes you have to just let go and completely surrender to whatever is out there and say, I believe and trust to, you know, the highest good for me from the universe. So I just open up and I want to receive where it wants me to go, how it wants things to unfold and happen that would be most beneficial for me and others, because, you know, the universe has this higher perspective, you know, it can see basically the past and the future and where you are and what's happening. And we can't see all that. We have very limited perspective from where we are, unfortunately. We may think even, oh, I want this, I might want that, but it's always good to listen. And the confirmation of the connection with yourself and truth coming in is that you feel that ease and flow, and you feel, you know, when you're picked up by like a strong current in the river and taken further, and you feel like, oh, I can feel excitement, it looks like it's a great journey. And in that realm, you know, you are being, you don't think about result, you just enjoy the ride, you enjoy the flow. You got there and you feel this kind of, I call it, you feel energy building up, you know, joy bubbling. What is joy? To me, it's this bubbling energy, energy building up. You anticipate something good. You feel great along the ride. So how can it go wrong? I mean, you really don't care, you know, what will be the destination as long as you got there into this flow and it feels so great. It can't be wrong. But as soon as it makes you contract and close and there is something to explore, and figure out for yourself, is it you closing down from, you know, something that you may not like about yourself? Is it not right time? Is it not right thing for you? Or what's there? Because if it's right, you'll definitely know it. You'll have no doubts. It's like, woohoo, I'm going on a big journey. And it's all just great anticipation of all the things that are about to come. So it's not like judging and, oh, shall I do this, shall I not, and is it right? No, it's, you know it. It comes with knowing, and it just takes you there. But you need to allow for these currents to take you off the ground, because if we hold on, you know, to our, sometimes another block is our own, as I said, expectations. We expect things to be a certain way because that's how it worked in the past. That's how it works for our friends or whatever, but they have their reality of the world. So, and you hold on to that and you are unable to give up your beliefs and you are unable to fully trust, to have this faith. That's another serious, you know, concept to explore, you know, but it's critical. So open and trustful and listening to yourself, you will understand if you are there or not and how far you are.
What you're saying reminds me of my Buddhist studies where you're supposed to let go of the self. So maybe I've been, you know, maybe I've been focusing too much on it, but I think it is still important to know yourself, to accept yourself, like you say. But how to transcend it, maybe that's where, you know, I'm a little stuck right now. But, I mean, in Buddhist teachings, you got to let go of the self. And it sounds an awful lot like what you're saying.
I think, yeah, just staying extremely open. And, I mean, it's when we talk about, you know, opening your heart and all these meditations, again, when as soon as you open your heart, you become extremely vulnerable. And I remember, again, another experience of mine during the same transpersonal workshops, this holotropic breath work. After one of the workshops, after, you know, breathing session, I felt very, very vulnerable in here, in this, you know, in my heart center. So I even had to take, you know, we used blankets, you know, to lie on the floor while we're doing breath work. So I had to take blanket and just hug with it. And like everyone was, you know, in the integration after the session was looking at me like, what are you doing? Why are you hugging with the blanket? And I had to say, you know, I feel so vulnerable. I kind of, it's just me, open me, like, you know, naked, not physically naked, but just, and I feel this vulnerability of life inside me, how vulnerable I am, how imperfect maybe, how, just when you truly open up, you need some courage to do that. It's hard to sustain that state. So we kind of naturally, just by reflex, we kind of tend to close up very quickly. But that's the true state of being, when you're fully open, when you fully accept. To me, vulnerability also means fully accepting our human nature. I mean, to me, being human means being vulnerable, being with an open heart, you know, being able to be compassionate and, you know, empathetic and sense things and receive things at the same time. So it all comes in one kind of bundle. You can't separate it. So you have to forgive. Otherwise, you'll be always protective and fighting, and you will never end, you know, in where you would like to be, you know, just running smoothly all these energies through you. And as I said, getting into the flow and enjoying the ride. Because if you observe nature, that's how I came to it as well, you know, observing nature. And, you know, I think everyone else is meditating all the time. The trees, the frogs, the clouds, are they stressful? Are they thinking, you know, we need to ride, you know, run faster through the sky? Or not at all. Does the tree think I'm not quite cute enough? I don't have straight forms. Doesn't care. It's as beautiful as it is, you know. It's just us as human beings always distorting this flow, always interfering, always protecting, not trusting. But we all have our reasons for that, right? We all, our stories, our history, we have our filters inbuilt, and through them we see the world. So it's just opening, clearing, and all up, like clearing your front screen of front window of your car, so you can see a clear perspective of where you are going, without these blockages and not quite clear. We have some spots there. There is rain, and or you have just fancy idea in your mind that completely blocks the where you are going. You're just holding on to some idea from the past. You can't see that. Oh, it's new times. The reality has changed. It's all different. You're still holding on to, you know, I don't know, girls or boys' story of how bad you are doing this or something else, which is irrelevant. It's just irrelevant. Everything is changing. It's irrelevant. It's outdated. Throw it away and stay open and you'll see. Yeah, I hope that was helpful.
There's an element of faith here that I had not really recognized before. You know, your faith that you have this potential as a human being, that you can find it and develop it, I think is what I'm hearing here.
The more you talk to people who have it,
Sana, I want to. I wanted to talk to you about that. You know, that state of vulnerability. Because, you know, I felt it too. I had a couple of times where I've kind of remembered that this was the state that I was when I was a child. And I was very open, and I could, and then I had this idea, like, how can I be so open? How can I live in this open state? Because I feel so sensitive, so vulnerable. And I think people, when they hear the word vulnerable, really don't mean that you're so in tune with everything that's going on around you. You feel it so deeply that is just, there's no separation. And I guess I there's some fear to be in that open state. And I wonder for yourself, when you're that open, what do you do when you feel that vulnerability? Do you feel it pass through you, or do you feel like it sticks to you? I guess that's really the question. How do you live in that open state and be okay? I guess this is the question I'm asking. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does make perfect sense, because when you say that, how can you stay vulnerable? It means you still need to remember that you have protection, right? You don't have to worry about it. You are safe, right? And that's where faith comes in. And that's where, if you want to try to exercise some, you know, meditation, you can do the exercise where, for example, I sometimes imagine, like in the morning, where I wake up and I do have nightmares sometimes and not very nice dreams, and I feel quite vulnerable, you know, quite anxious, and I don't like it. I'm open, but I don't like that. So I need to kind of remember and get this sense that I'm safe, everything is okay. So you go and just imagine how you say, if you're wearing clothes, but that's your energy clothes, it's something like an energy dress or energy shirt that you put on, and it's very soothing and supporting and loving and caring and accepting. Whatever I said, whatever the best qualities you can imagine, you know, that someone, in Russian we have expression, unfortunately I forgot the English word for that, but say, imagine the feeling if you're a little kitten, right, a little kitten, and then there is big human, for you it's like you are a kitten and this big human is a god, and it takes you as a kitten and puts you under there and holds you there, you know, protectively. So you are sitting there on the god's chest, feeling fully loved, fully cared, fully accepted, and that's a very safe place to be. So my kind of meditation is exercises either to imagine that shirt or dress around me, or just imagine like I'm that kitten on the god's chest, and I'm fully protected, and there is nothing I should worry about because I'm fully taken care of. So I guess that was a good metaphor, a good example how you can feel there on the god's chest, fully protected. It's warm and safe and nice, and I know someone cares and loves me, and there is nothing to worry about. So you have to find that kind of ground, right? Because you kind of, it's like electrical wire needs to be grounded, right? Otherwise it will burn itself. So same thing with vulnerability. You need to find that ground where you can land something you can, it's also, you know, if you're doing yoga or other things, to relax, you really have to lean to something, right? Like lying on the floor, you will tend to relax more than holding yourself in a vertical position with straight back, and you understand. So you have need something strong, hard, reliable, you can lean on. So I guess for me, finding that virtual space, or that God space on the chest, you know, for the kitten, that I can land and, you know, feel myself comfortable and at the same time staying open. That's the goal. That's the way.
I think of that sort of the blanket, you know, those little blankets kids used to wear, you know, you have that blanket around you.
So yeah, you're protected. Yeah.
I wonder if Oksana's giving us all a biofeedback landmark.
Yeah, imagine yourself a little kitten. I mean, kittens are very vulnerable, right? And sweet and soft, and I mean, they need maximum care and protection and love. So that's how you feel. That's how it is, and it shouldn't be otherwise, really.
Beautiful, Oksana. Thank you for sharing that. It was almost like you gave us a psychology of meditation from the inside.
Oh, thank you, Judith. When you announced the topic, I, you know, wasn't thinking, and then one morning I woke up and thought, oh, I really have to say something, because it's, I remember myself, and you're absolutely right, everyone is meditating as a child. We just live in that state, and then we lose this state. And right. I remember myself, I was always in bed thinking about past, thinking about future, or just drifting into, you know, nice memories where I was, and I was fully in that, I don't know, on the beach, on vacation with my mother, and all great experiences. Or I can drift somewhere into the future, imagining myself, and again, getting great sensations from there. So it kind of, this self-reflection, it comes naturally to me. And then I don't know, I just intuitively and naturally was heading in direction of self-mastery. and like picking up different tools along the way and making notes, you know, for myself, what works, what doesn't work. I'm quite, you know, practical and being quite a sensitive person and quite aggressive, competitive world. For me, it was the only way to survive, just find my way, how I can adapt, how I can adjust, what are the ways, what works, what doesn't work. Why does it feel wrong, you know, constant like anxiety? It feels wrong and it's not right. I have to change it. And what does it mean to feel anxious? Oh, it's lack of truth. It's lack of just me being me, just allowing things to be as they are, allowing myself to be present. And then with time, you know, it evolved to where I am now. And I guess that's something, yeah, really, I can share things because I've been doing lots of work. It just naturally happens. It's my nature.
That is the development of a sage, isn't it? I mean, it is. And this is another Edgar Cayce definition that I really like. And it's that that you learn through self-reflection and self-transformation, and then you step out to teach others. And once you start to teach others, then you're sage. And if you can maintain the transformative being, your transformed beingness, then you're a master. And I think that's our goal here, isn't it, ultimately? I mean, that's what we don't necessarily always want to go into meditation and have a specific goal, but if we want to be happy and productive, self-actualized people, meditation clearly is the way. And the beautiful thing about it is that rarely do you come out of a meditation that you don't feel so much better and maintain that stride. And that's what makes us go back. So let us go back again and again. I think it's about time for us to close our program. But before we do, does anybody have any last minute questions or observations?
Judith, I guess I just want to sort of throw out there this idea that, you know, I really believe that when you said that really meditation is the true pathway to evolution, right? That really change happens through the meditation, allowing the energy, whether it's coming down from the crown to the root or from the root to the crown, that's otherwise you're just feel like you're just, you know, you're adding knowledge, you're, you know, you're developing the ego. It's like, you know, it's like moving chairs on the Titanic. You know, you're like you're doing something, but really you're just sort of reshuffling the same old sort of ego consciousness. But meditation, I think, is really the true way to evolve, to change, and that's the only way I've ever found it for myself, is that flow of energy. So I just wanted to throw that out.
Lovely. I agree with you 100%. We're all in the same basket for that same purpose and effect and evolutionary effect, not just on ourselves but other people, because obviously we're going to externalize the changes that we make inside. Yeah. So, is someone having a breathing exercise?
That holotropic breathing Garth is doing.
Right?
I guess it should be more intensive, but yeah, breathing exercise is always good. I should say we are not in the basket, we're in the boat. We're all in the same boat because we are in the flow and we're moving somewhere and evolving and or getting stuck along the way, but we're on the journey.
Absolutely. Absolutely. The reed basket on the riverfront. Great. Thank you all so much for being here. This has been really fascinating, interesting, full of epiphanies, I think, for all or most of us, certainly for me. And thank you, Oksana, for sharing from your heart and your spirit at the same time. Everybody, come back and we'll do it some more.
Thank you very much.
Yes, will do. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.